Hello everyone. Today Gabriele is going to present, is going to continue the work started last time. I just want to say one thing for everyone, and I think it's really cool. We have arranged a special talk for the 4th of June, in which Mattias Fay is going to present and explain how the project of PyTorch Geometric has been developed and what are next challenges, who he is. And just for introduce you, he is the developer of PyTorch Geometric. I'm happy you can spam and publicize it so that he can have a lot of audience. Okay, Gabriele, I think you can start.
Okay, so thank you. And can you see the PDF, the slides here? Do you see them? Yes, okay, perfect. Okay, so welcome everybody. This is Antonio Anticipated. It's the second part of this tutorial on DeepWalk and Node2Vec. And this time we concentrate on implementation details. So a summary of the tutorial is the following. So we start by recalling some idea from last time, and then we go into the details of bias random works. So this is the basic building block of the both method, and so actually the biased one only of Node2Vec, while DeepWalk uses unbiased one. But anyhow, biased are more general one, and they include also the unbiased one. So we'll discuss this one, and we'll see the code in PyTorch Geometric and some example of those. And then another thing that was open since last time was how to actually compute the loss function. So we will recall a couple of ideas and see how that is done. And finally, we see a full, so we put everything together and we see a full implementation of the two methods. Actually, we will see Node2Vec, and that will be clear in a moment why we see only that. So let's start. So last time we motivated this method with the goal of finding a good representation of a graph. So in particular, we want to find the embedding of the nodes. So we want to associate to every node V a vector. So this F1 is a number, FD of V is a final number. So every node is associated to D number, so to one vector, okay? And we want to find a good F such that the representation, so if you replace the node with a D dimensional vector, so with the D dimensional vector represented by F, this representation is good enough to do machine learning over the graph. So in particular is a representation, so a latent representation, an embedding, call it as you wish. But this vector is good enough to represent the graph for any possible purpose. So we have seen last time that these two methods find representation or embeddings which are good independently of the task that we want to solve later. Okay, so they are not task dependent. And just to be practical, last time we have seen that, so since we associate to every node one vector, finding an embedding is the same thing as finding a vector for every node. So at the end of the day, it's just our task is just to find a matrix with where every row is the embedding of one node, and so the number of rows is equal to the number of nodes. Okay, and we have seen that Node2Vec and DeepWalk use a very specific and quite clever strategy. So they try to optimize this F, this matrix or function F, or this embedding in a way that preserves the similarities that are present within the graph. And how these similarities are defined is based on a neighborhood notion. Okay, so we want nodes that are in a neighborhood, so in the respective neighborhood, to have similar embedding. And this notion of neighborhood, in turn, is not based only on first-order neighbors, but is based on a biased random walk. So we take a node, we sample a random walk, and the nodes that are on this random walk are considered to be the neighbors of this one. And we sample several random walks, and we want we try to make the embedding preserving this kind of similarity of the graph. Okay. So that was the idea, and we start now with the random walks. So just to recall, this is the definition of this one way to see the transition function for an unbiased random walk. So we have a probability, assuming that the ith node in the walk is u, we want to have a definition of the probability of transitioning to another node at the next iteration. And it's defined to be zero if there is no connection. So we cannot jump from U to V if there is no edge connecting them. And otherwise is defined as a number if there is an edge. And this number, the title was unbiased random walk. So this number is defined like that. So it's a ratio between a transition probability, which is unnormalized in general. And this can be defined, for example, to be equal to the weight of the node, or for example, to one if the node is of the edge, sorry. The weight of the edge. If the edge is unweighted, we can just assign this to be one. And then there is a normalization factor Z that just takes care of the fact that we want this one to be a probability. Okay, so it, for example, you can divide, if pi is the weight of the node, you can divide by the sum, again, sorry, it's the weight of the edge. You can divide by the sum of all the weights of the edges start from you, for example. Okay, this is unbiased, so essentially assuming that the weights is one everywhere, this random walk is unbiased in the sense that from every node you have the same probability of jumping in any neighborhood node. And instead we want to have a more general notion, which is the one of biased random walk. So we introduce this alpha, which is called a search bias. And we modified the transition probability to have it biased. So instead of having as it was, we just multiply it by a factor. Okay. And this is a second order notion, as we have seen last time. So we assume to start from T being now in V, and we want to compute the probability to go in any one of the other nodes. And we do that by assigning a different weight to the different direction. So depending on dx, which is the distance between V and the next node. So, sorry, it's between the distance between the previous node, T, and the next node. So any one of the one where we go starting from V. So depending on the distance of this node from T, we assign a different weight. So the first one, distance zero, is coming back to T after we went to V, and we have a probability of 1 over P. Then the distance one is exactly this x1 here. So we assign a unit probability. So we have three numbers. So to parameterize them is sufficient to have to normalize one to one, and the other two are just scaling factors. Yeah, and then the distance may be two. So the other two nodes are at distance one plus one from T, and we assign a third probability of going down. So a scaling factor of going down. And playing with these numbers, we can bias the random walk. So we can modify the basic transition probability in order to suggest to the random walk either to come back or to explore. And as we have seen last time, these two parameters are called the return parameter P and the in-out parameter Q. So one, the return parameter, if it is large, it tries to, so it gives more probability to exploration, and the opposite, so if it is small, it gives more probability to backtracking, so to going back, and the opposite is true for the in-out parameter. Okay. So we have seen this last time, and it's quite easy to see that if you change them according to these, so larger or smaller, you get a larger or smaller probability of this action. And so this is the definition for nodes to VAC. And as we mentioned last time, deep walk at this level is just given by setting Q equal P equal 1. So essentially the search bias is constantly 1, so there is no bias at all. So the random walks are unbiased. Okay, so this is the main difference between node to VAC and deep walk. And this is actually also the difference, so the reason why we will see only the implementation of node to VAC. So because essentially whenever you take, so we will see that the default values for this P and Q is exactly 1 in the implementation, which means that by default, the implementation is deep walk. And if we change them, we can add other parameters and the general node to VAC implementation. Okay, so now let's see the implementation of this. So this is the interface of the class node to VAC in PyTorch geometric. And let's see, so it takes a lot of inputs, and let's see the ones that are relevant for the random walk part. So first, there is this length parameter. So the walk length, which is the length of the random walk which is sampled. And then there are these parameter P and Q, which are exactly the return and in-out parameter that we just discussed here. And then there is this context size. And this, so if you recall the other time, we discussed the fact that one way to sample random walks is to sample, so one efficient way is to sample a long one. So for example, last time we had this example with a length of 6, and then use this length with this long random walk and split it into part and take out multiple random walks. Okay, so you take, having a long random walk, you can just start looking at the first one, so you get one random walk, start looking at the second, you get a second, and so on. Okay, and so these walk length and context parameter are exactly L and K. So the context is K, okay, and the name context comes from this fact that we discussed last time, so the analogy with the word embedding algorithm, and the context in that case was given by the neighboring word in a sentence. In this case, we have no notion of neighborhood except when we sample. So this k equal 3 is exactly the context size, or so the length of the neighborhood or the random walk that we use. And this walk length instead is the L, so it's the length of the stem of the random walk that we actually sample for computational convenience. Okay. And within node vector, this random sampling is implemented in a very clever way, so via the loader. Okay, so we see the implementation in a moment. But if you remember when we discussed the data loader in general in PyTorch, but also in PyTorch geometry, that is something that essentially whenever you call it, so if you have a data set, you call the data loader, you can iterate over the data loader, and at every time it gives you a batch of data from your data set. In our case, we are trying to, so we see the graph as a set of random walks. So whenever we want to sample something from the dataset, all we want to do actually is to sample a batch of random walks. So this loader does exactly that. So we see the implementation now. So this is the definition of the function within the class. So in principle, the loader just defined a data loader. So this is the general PyTorch interface to define a general data loader, and we need to pass the basic object to take, so the basic data set to take object from. And this is just a range, so it's a list with the same length of the, so this is the number of nodes, is the size of the adjacency matrix, and then the range just give the list from 0 to the size. So this actually is a list with the number identified every node, okay? So actually the data loader, every time we call it, it will give us a subset of the list of full nodes, which means just a list of nodes, okay? So that's exactly a walk. So in principle, so at this level of generality, it's just a list of nodes of the graph. And then we also pass a sampling function. So this collateFM is just the function used to sample. When we randomly sample from this set, we do it accordingly to this sampling function. And this is also, that's what it just said. And this is the implementation within the class of this sample function that we pass. So the first part only checks that the type is correct, so ignore the first thing. And then what it does, it returns a list, so it calls on the batch. So recall that the batch is just a list of nodes, okay? And what it gives back are two elements, so a bunch of positive samples and a bunch of negative samples. So we are going to see what they are. So just recall that the batch here is a batch of indices. So really, these one are just two lists of a few nodes in the graph. Okay, and the positive and negative sampling function are defined like these. So sorry for the line numbers here, but I didn't know how to take a nice screenshot that put the two methods side by side. So let's see the positive sample one. So this actually is the one that we expect. So the negative one is only a technical thing that we'll understand later why we need this, but it's easy to understand the code. So let's see. So let's see the positive sample first. So it's all based on the random walk function, which is actually implemented in Torch cluster. Okay. So this is a way to sample random walks. And what it wants is the row and column. So this is a sparse representation of the adjacency matrix. Okay. So you see, is the adjacency matrix, then this is just a sparse metric operation, but essentially it gives us two vectors representing the entries of the sparse matrix. But these are just technical things. And then this batch, so if you look at the implementation of random walk, This third variable is a list of starting node. So that means that random walk now, so if we pass a list of 100, so if batch is of length 128, as it will be later, it means that batch is a list of 128 nodes in the graph, and it means that this function will start 128 random walks from every one of these nodes and return the list of nodes, okay? The list of random walks, and everyone is a list of nodes. And then we need to specify the parameter that we have seen before, so the length of the walk to be sampled, and then P and Q, okay? And this samples the random walk in the biased random walk. Then, yeah, this is just a check. And when that is done, we just want from this one to extract all. So observe that here we sample the random walks of length, walk length. So what remains to do is to do as we did before. So we had, so this is like 6 before, and we want to extract random walks of length 3. And this now is done by this second loop. So we just initialize the walk to be an empty list. Then we compute how many walks we will obtain. So this is the formula that we have seen before. So it's just a number of, there is a plus one because it depends on how many are sampled by this one, but essentially it depends on the distance between, the difference between L and K, as we saw before. And then what the iteration does is just to save the random walks by taking the long random walk that we had before and taking out only the short, so a lot of shorts one, okay? So this is exactly doing these three lines here, but exactly doing this operation here. Take a long one, go through it, and extract a lot of short random walks, okay? But the important thing here is that the random walks are sampled by, as we saw before, so by using some biased and looking at adjacency metrics. So these are the positive samples. The negative samples, on the other way, we will see later, these are a list of fake random walks. So these are really walks that are obtained by walking through the graph by using the adjacency metrics. These one, on the other end, are random ones, so they are not really representing the graph. And indeed, the only difference, so the second part is exactly the same. So starting from a long walk, just extract a lot of short ones. The first one part is different because what it does, instead of sampling random walks from the metrics, they just initialize random integer, so random index of nodes, okay? So if we sample from this one, we are actually sampling random, really random walks in the sense that they have no connection with the underlying graph, they may be anything. And in that sense, these are negative, so they are fake examples of random walks that can be found in the graph. Okay? So we will see later why we need this one, but it just made sense to see them at this moment because they are created in the same place. Yeah. So now we move to the code to see an example of this. So here a moment. Do you have questions so far?
I have a question. If a path in the negative walks happens to be a real path? Do we care? Do we remove them?
No, I think it's also very difficult to check if that's the case because you should look for every. No, we don't care at all. So later on, I will explain why we need those negative ones, but they made sense only. So the only thing that we. So they will be used, the positive and negative one will be used only to represent two distributions. So essentially it makes not a big difference if some negative example is also present in the graph, okay?
And it
will be also very computationally very expensive to check for every negative one to check if it is in the graph or not, I would say. Maybe not very, but at least it will increase the complexity, yeah. Okay, good. So let's see that. So this is the code. So first, I added a link to the two papers and also to the documentation and actual implementation of Node2Vec in Python Geometric. And also the third link is an example on the use of this algorithm clustering, which is the one that we are going to use in this tutorial. Okay. So let's start. So these are some imports, and it's nothing. So the only relevant thing is that Node2Vec is implemented within Tor's geometric and N. Okay. So if you want to reuse it, and all the rest is just a standard thing. Then we load a dataset, so it's the one that we use already. So it's just the Corona dataset. I downloaded it already. If you run it and you don't have it, it will download this one for you. And then we do the usual thing, so we move everything on CUDA if we have any. And then this is the actual definition. So we define a model, which is a Node2Vec model, and it takes as input so the edge index. So this is a representation of the graph. And then a bunch of things that that depend on what we want to do. So this is the embedding dimension, which was that D that we have in F. So every node is represented by a 128 dimensional vector. Okay. Then these are the things that we have seen already. So the work length, the context length. This is another, so P and Q are equal to one at the moment. And then these two, so the number of negative samples, we are going to see it later. And works per node means how many works we want to generate for every node and every iteration. And we are going to see in a moment what is an iteration. But the thing that we care about now are the work length, the context size, and the bias parameters. Okay. So now we are just at the first stage, we are just using this class to generate random works. So what we do is to take, so as we have seen before, the model as a data loader, so a loader within. And it requires a batch size, 128. This means that we generate 128 random works in every batch. Not really, actually, because then we have our works per node, which is 20. So actually, at every iteration, we generate 128 times 20 random works, okay? And then these are usual parameters, so to move it on, use multiple workers and shuffle the nodes at every iteration. Now I want to show you what happens here. So we are just going to iterate through the loader. So remember, so this is going is a full epoch, so we are running over the entire data set. Every time we sample 128 nodes from the graph, and that's the reason we have 21 batches, okay? Because that's correspond to the number of nodes in the graph. Then for every one of these 128, we generate 20 random works. So 20 times 128 random works. And we generate them to be of length 20. And then with that operation as before, so splitting it into a shorter one, we split these long random works in a lot of random works. And that gives exactly these. So we have this, the first row, the first column is the index of random work of the batch, and then we have the size of the positive batch and the negative batch. And as you can see, we have this lot of random works, and every random work is represented by a node, which is exactly the context. Okay, so we see one in detail. So we just take one positive and negative work from the data loader. Okay, the index is zero because we start from the first one. Then the shape is the one that we've just seen. So these are the positive and negative classes. So as you can see, every random work is just a list of 10. So these are 10 numbers. And these are random works starting from the node 2614 and then going blah, blah, blah. And then we do it for a lot of different nodes, okay? Okay, and the negative one instead is generated as we have seen before by just randomly picking the next index, okay? And we can see a bunch of them. So at the moment we have P equal Q equal one. So we have unbiased random work. And what happens? So I just convert my graph to a network X object just to make it easier to visualize that. So I just take the edge index from my data and I transform it to a list of tuples of edges, and I generate the graph from those edges. And then this is just a way to get a faster visualization. So I assign a fake position to every node in the graph so that later, so this takes a moment to compute because it needs to compute. So this prick layout needs to position. There are different layout functions in networks. And this, I mean, they take some time to find nice position of the nodes. But then once this is done, the plotting is faster. So should be done in a moment. Okay. Now what we do in the plotting, so I just take as node list, I sample one positive random walk from the data loader. And then I define a sum graph representing the random walk. So it's just the graph generated by only those lists. And I assign position, and then I just plot that. So and what you see on the left is the full graph without the edges, because otherwise it's impossible to see. But this is the full Cora graph in blue, and in red is the random walk. And since it's almost invisible, I also zoom it in the, on the right. So on the right is the same random walk that is there. Okay. So if I sample another one, it works like that. Okay. So this, at this stage, they are just convincingly random. But what I want to show you is that we can change the parameter. So we can increase, for example, P of quite a lot. So we have a larger P, so the return parameter is larger. And that means that if everything works nicely, we should expect, so I redefine also, I will take out the loader, and if that works nicely, we should have graphs which are, so random walks which are, yeah, let's see it. Yeah. Okay. So it's probably not so visible here. Okay, they tend to stay, you see, there are random walks, so there are still, every time there are 10 nodes, but sometimes they also collapse on the same one, because they tend to be, so what we are doing is to prefer going back to nodes that have been visited already, okay? And instead, if we do the opposite, so we keep these back to one, and these to large one. So let's see, now we add this in-out parameter to be larger, and that hopefully will mean that we are, no, did I, here, order, nope, am I mixing the two? Do you see the problem or? Because it's the opposite, it's one over Q. Yeah, I'm doing exactly the opposite, sorry. Let me show you. I was doing exactly the opposite. So now I took Q large, and so is the opposite. So when the in-out parameter is large, it means that Q is large. So we are taking almost zero probability of doing steps of length through two, okay? And that's exactly the opposite when P is large, okay? So actually the behavior for Q is the one that we expected, because now we get all, now we have Q large, and indeed we only get walks that go back to the same node, and so they bounce from one node to the other one, so this is okay. So let's try again with P, what happens? Set Q equal 1 to undo. Yeah, probably that was what we had before. So we just need to have it a bit more. Yeah. So, okay. So these are okay. We get the words that also go away from what they started the session. So I tested it with longer ones before, and you see it a bit more strongly. Okay. Okay. So this is the way that random walks are used within Node2Vec in PyTorch geometric. Now we can go back to the slide. Sorry, I go back to the point where we are. Okay, and now we go to the loss. So the second ingredient that we had last time is that we use these random walks to generate some loss. So the first thing for that is I want to show you how the embedding is represented within the class of Node2Vec, and is represented by this object embedding, which is just from the usual PyTorch package. It's not a geometric object. And this just represents an embedding, so it's a lookup table, so with n objects, so the number of nodes in our case. Then we need to specify the embedding dimension, and then this sparse flag is just a technical thing that tells us how to compute the gradient of this. But essentially, this is a matrix of size n times embedding dimension stored in a convenient way. Okay, so this is the representation of our f of the nodes. And given this, so last time you have seen that the loss is computed by maximizing this probability here. So we have a fixed function f that we want to optimize. And what we want to do is to try to maximize the probability of a neighborhood given a node u. So we sample a neighborhood from using a random walk. So this ns of u is a random walk starting in u. And this gives us a list of nodes close to u. And then we compute the probability as the product of the probability of every element in the walk, and it's computed like this. So it's a ratio of two terms. So one is the exponential of the inner product between the representation of my nodes, so the central, the initial node, and any node on the walk, and that is normalized by the sum of this quantity over the entire network. And the reason we need this normalization is that when we maximize this, if you omit the normalization, that what will happen is just that we keep enlarging f everywhere, right? So what to maximize a quantity, the solution is just take f with as large entries as possible. But then with this normalization, when we maximize this is implicitly requiring that we get a large value for the nodes that are close with respect to the random walk, but it needs to be small everywhere else, okay? So we have seen last time the motivation for this one. But then the problem is that this operation here, so this division is very expensive because it requires the computation of this quantity for every node in the graph. Okay, so that will mean that every time that you want to evaluate this term, you will need in principle to evaluate it also for every node on the graph. And that may take a lot of time. So actually the way that Node2Vec solves this problem is via this idea of negative sampling. Actually, DeepWalk uses another one, so which is called a hierarchical softmax, but we are not going to see that. So that's the other difference, actually, between Node2Vec and DeepWalk. And this idea of negative sampling is a bit involved, but there are two main steps that I'm going to mention. So the first one is that last time we have seen that we can maximize the logarithm of this one. So if you take the logarithm, a lot of exponential and ratios disappear, and you can rewrite the loss as these, so a term that depends only on the current nodes, and then an expectation, so actually a mean of the same quantity over all nodes, but now the expectation is computed with respect to another probability p. So actually, if you manipulate this expression, you get this second expectation here, and you have a factor that looks like a probability, so it's something between 0 and 1. And that needs to be computed. So at this stage, computing this one is as difficult as computing the one that we had before. But now there is the trick. So we need to compute this expectation of our own node of the graph according to a probability. And the idea is to split, so to sample this probability, so is to observe that this probability represents two classes, the class of nodes which are in the random walk, so which are close to you, and the ones which are not, okay? So the idea to approximate this one and avoiding visiting the entire graph is to take a bunch of nodes that are close to you, and a bunch of nodes which are not close to you. So actually, that's the reason of the name. So we do a positive sampling of the nodes, so we sample some node from the positive class, so from the class of nodes that are really close to you, and some node from the negative class, okay? And the way this is done by Node2Vec, so sampling the positive and negative class is exactly by sampling true random walks and fake random walks. So we want to approximate the expectation over the entire set of nodes. And the entire set of nodes is divided into classes. And at every iteration, instead of computing all of them, we just sample a bunch of true random walks and a bunch of fake random walks, and we use them as approximation of the entire graph. And that is to answer the question that I had before. That's the reason why I think we don't care so much if there are a bunch of some random walks in the fake class and the negative class that are a real one should not matter that much within the expectation if we have enough of them. Okay. And just for the ones that want to get the details of these, there is a very nice tutorial. So there are a lot of resources online, papers and whatever. I found this one very detailed and very, very comprehensive. So it does all the computation and motivates everything very nicely if you want to see how to end up with the final formula here. But we are going to skip it here, and we are just going to see how this is implemented in PyTorch. So before going to the details of the computation of the loss, I want to show you the class. So we have seen the other parameters before, but it takes also this number of negative samples, which is just as is written in the documentation, the number of negative samples that are used for every positive sample. So essentially, when we sample here, using the default of 1, it means that every time we sample a positive, so a true random walk, we sample a fake one. If the number changes, it means that we sample more fake ones than real ones. Okay. So let's see the implementation. So this is the last step, so it's the actual loss, and it is divided into parts. So let's go through it line by line. So the first thing takes a random walk, and it takes out the first node, so the start node, and the rest. So the rest of the random walk, okay, and then it computes. So we need to compute this quantity here. So fu, fv, and fu, okay. And u is the initial node, v is the rest of the nodes, so the one in the neighborhood. And actually, it does that. So it computes the embedding. So the h start is f of u. So it's the embedding of the starting node, and then the embedding of the rest of the nodes. And then here, this is the inner product, so out is easy because it's just the inner product, so it is this first term here. And then the second one is this approximation that I mentioned of the positive of the expectation over the positive class. So for reason that we have not time to discuss, but you can find them in the tutorial at the end of the day, that is just corresponding to the log of the sigmoid of this embedding here over the entire positive class. Okay, and then the same thing is done on the negative random walk. So we divide the first node in every random walk from the rest. We compute the two embedding, and we do the same calculation with the difference that the negative loss has a different form. Okay, so it's 1 minus the sigmoid. And then the final loss is just given by the sum of the two terms. Okay, and this is actually the approximation of the exact loss that we have seen before. Okay, and but as you see here, everything is very, so again, the details are a bit complicated, but the important message is that everything is based on random walks and only on the one that we sample. So there is no place here where we need to visit the entire graph. And I just want to add one part that, as you see, both the positive and the negative loss are computed on the random walks. And the random walks here are a batch of random walks, so a lot of them. And actually, the only operation that is left to do to get numbers is to compute the mean. So actually, we are not just taking this sum, this product here, but you're also computing the mean of this representation over a lot of different random walks. And that is our final loss. Okay. And two things that are remaining in the implementation of the method of the class within PyTorch Geometric is the forward method, but this is really simple because we just need to compute the embedding. So this just returns the weights of the embedding, so the metrics that we just computed. And it can return the entire one or just the one corresponding to a list of nodes. And then there is also a test method that we will see during the implementation. Okay, so this is the end of the slide, and I show you the final part of the implementation. So we are back here. So we first define, so I redefine everything just to be sure. There is also an optimizer, so in this case it's a sparse Adam, but you can use what you prefer. Then there is a training function, and this just implements the ideas before. So we go through the graph by going through the random walks in the loader. As usual, we set to zero the gradient. Then we compute the loss using the positive and the negative random walks. And then we just optimize. Sorry, we set the gradient and then we optimize, and then we just save the loss. Okay, so this is very easy. It's just repeating the operation over one epoch of the data loader. And then I just want you to show you how the testing is done. So actually, we have, so I should have kept that open. Okay, but in the data, we have also a Y column. So is a list of classes of every node. So we use it also last time. And it's just like that. So and the classes are these classes from 0 to 6. So what is done during the testing is just to compute the embedding of the model. So this is an embedding, right? So for every node, we have that 128-dimensional vector. And then the way the model is tested is just to use, so let me go back to the slides. So this testing function is just computing, so it's using some train input and train label, test input and test label, and a logistic regression to try to, so we are just solving a very easy regression problem using the what we pass to the testing. Okay, and actually what we are passing to the testing in this case are exactly the labels of the classes. So we pass as input. Okay, so the target values are just the labels in the training and in the test set. The nice thing is that now we have a nice embedding of our graph, so we can use that simple logistic regression, which is just designed to work with vectorial data, but now we have a vectorial representation of our graph, which is given by the embedding. Okay, so this is what is done during testing. And I show you the training. So now I just limited that to 10 epochs, so it will not be very nice. So this is the bar is showing you the progress within every training epoch. So actually, it's running through all the batches of one epoch. So it's sampling a lot of random walks and optimizing. So so every time you see the bar moving, is the completion of one run of that number. So that was of almost 30,000 random walks being sampled and optimized, and the embedding being optimized accordingly, okay? So now I limited it because it's quite slow, but I can show you the final embedding. So this is not very good yet, but I can start it, or you can play with that. So if you move it to 100 epochs, it will be very nice. And what we do in the visualization is just to take the embedding of the nodes corresponding to the different classes, and we cluster them, and we try to see, we don't use the embedding, we don't use the label, we just use clustering of the different embedding, and we just visualize them. So now they look all in the same place, but then they will nicely be separated into the classes corresponding to the labels. Okay, so let's just see, is it still running? Yeah, it takes a moment. So this is again with 10, but I can start it with a bit more, and yeah, it will take time, but if you use close to 100, you will see a very nice representation. Okay, that's it. And is there any question?
Gabriele, yes, actually I have a question. So last time you were also showing us that you can perform basically edge to vec, okay, by simply taking I don't know, the average or some other operation based on the embeddings of the node. Is there anything already implemented in PyTorch Geometric for this? Because it's a very little modification, but is there anything?
I haven't seen it in this class, but I think it's really a few lines of code. So you just need to pass a pair of nodes, and it will return instead of returning. So I mean, you just need a forward, a modification of the forward that takes instead of a batch, it will take a batch of edges essentially. So.
Yeah. I was asking because maybe there was something already implemented, like some fancy ways.
I haven't seen that. But also in the original paper, they suggest to use simple operation like release average or product or things like that. So.
Okay. Because similar embeddings are going to be similar also when merged. Yes.
Yeah. Probably you can play around with the parameters of the random walk, because maybe the kind of similarity that you want to enforce on nodes is not the same that you want to enforce on edges, maybe. So I think edges, I don't know. I think they need to be optimized in a way, but it would be interesting to test it for sure. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so if there are no other questions, I think we can stop here.
I have one.
Yeah, sure.
Does it make sense to sort of compose like the approaches of DeepWalk or Not2Vec and other GNN models we've seen? For example, I'm thinking of, an unsupervised task that we want to tackle with GNN. But we have no data for the vertices except the graph topology itself. Would it make sense to generate embeddings with Not2Vec and then use the GNN, or is it like redundant and useless?
Yeah, but I think I get your idea, but I think if you use an embedding technique, then you just forget about the graph. You just have a list of, so you have a Euclidean, so like vector representation. So for sure you can use that for, so you can use a standard neural network on the embedding if you want, because then they are just vectors now. There is no connection between nodes or anything. So do you see what I mean? Or?
Yeah, I think I got the point. It's already a vector, so we can use, reason to use a GNN.
Okay. Yeah. I don't know. Maybe the opposite can be done. So if you use a GNN, that you have a message passing, that you have again an adjacency matrix. Maybe you can use an embedding on the first layer, for example. That I think in principle. So from the algorithmic point of view, it can be done. So I see no limitation, but I don't know if it has been done and if it is convenient for the problem. I don't know.
Yeah. Thank you. It was just a curiosity.
Yeah, thank you.